opposition and you are making policies, this is very, very worrisome. Because it would mean whatever investment that you are making, building universities in Mpumalanga, in Northern Cape, expanding that, people won't be able to take advantage of those opportunities because their ability to do so will be impaired. Because as what I've said to you, that nutrition becomes a key pillar in relation to the growing of the economy, but also individuals being participating in the economy moving forward. So there is also issues of severe stunting, wasting, underweight, and severe underweight. There is a study that was done by DPME to compare South Africa with other economies that are equally comparative to South Africa, but also less. We are doing bad, even with other countries, compared to even other countries. I mean, for instance, countries like Zambia, Congo, countries like Uganda, countries like Ghana, Nigeria, if their stunting levels and their malnutrition levels compared to South Africa, I don't want to show you that. It's worrisome. But anyway, let me go ahead. But this is a really, really problem because the children from 1 to 3, this, the implication moving forward, is massive. It's not a small thing. And usually, in my view, and I agree with the guys who were there in Constitutional Hill and who were grilling us as government to say this is crime. It is crime. Because of the fact that the Constitution say every individual in South Africa shall have adequate access to food. You see how it becomes crime? Because the master law or the supreme law of the country says it is crime. And government, as a protector of those rights and the custodian of those rights enshrined in the Constitution, needs to take the responsibility in relation to reversing of this. And this is why I think discussion of this nature and views coming from the different aspect. I mean, if you look here in the room, we have got people representing various fields of expertise. And government can't come here and think that we are supreme, we can be able to derive policies that are better suited to deal with these issues. This is why we take advantage of opportunities like this to come and expose ourselves and expose such kind of data. Because in some countries, you won't see such. I mean, they would say, Sibongiseni, you can't go there and talk about this. I mean, because you are now, pointing the very same spear at yourself. But we need to point a spear to ourselves for us then to be able to solve the problem moving forward. Now, I need to move into the policy because I was dealing with the problem statement. But it's beyond this. I mean, the problem statement transcends beyond just agricultural production, economy, nutrition, and everything else. It's also about the mindset of individuals moving forward. I think that's going to become one of the key issues. Now I'm going to deal with the policy itself and the nuts and bolts of what the policy contains. This policy, which was approved by government, intends, that's a broader statement of intent, to deal with the issues or reduce food insecurity by 2030. My Dr. Takavarache here talked about 2025. That's an African agenda. And you see, the African agenda say we will have ended hunger by 2025, Dr. Takavarache, if I'm right. And the key issue is that what numbers are we dealing with? How big is this problem? How massive is this challenge? In South Africa, it's 14.1 million. It means at a rapid rate from now moving forward, we're in 2016, in the 14-year-old, you could then do your arithmetic in relation to how much we should reduce it. And I've shared with you that the last year we didn't reduce it, we increased. Because it's not only about the statement of intent, it's also about your macroeconomy environment where you find yourself in, which dictates what happens, you know, moving forward. But this is a broader statement of intent, but I think what government intends to do is that the NDP vision should also deal with the issues of food security and nutrition moving forward. These are the policy objectives, and I think we intend to improve nutrition safety nets by expanding the nutrition national school nutrition program, which are your basic government feeding programs, your CNTC's cash for work programs, which government is doing, but redirect it and be able to target to the individuals that are below the food poverty line or they are below the threshold I shared with you of 649 rand per month. And it needs to be direct because if it's a blanket approach, you won't be able to register a reduction. Improve nutrition education. It's a key issue, a very, very worrisome one because people like myself and agriculturalists, I don't regard nutrition education as one of the key things that we should do. But I've come to appreciate if you take a Coke can and you look and outside the nutrition indices, most of us, even as much as how much we are educated, we can't interpret that. What does it mean from the nutrition perspective? It's actually the same with all other commodities or other products we're consuming in the market. So student education becomes one of the key issues. And of course, in other countries like Canada, where literacy levels are very, very high, individuals...